Quand même, everybody, so this is the second lecture in the series of tutorial lectures by Edward Powell. So Edward has given a lecture last week and will speak today and next week about the use of Christoffel Darboux kernels in polynomial optimization. So the floor is yours, Edward. Thanks a lot.
Thank you very much. So, and thank you everybody for coming. So let me share my screen first. Up. Share. Now it should work. You should see my presentation.
Yes.
Okay, good. So let me just recap very quickly what we are like the main elements that we have seen last time. So we've been talking about the Christoffel Darboux kernel, and the Christoffel Darboux kernel is essentially related to the space of polynomials of degree at most d of a finite degree d, which is fixed, and it's related to a certain scalar product on this space, which is induced by a given measure mu, and we make assumption which ensure that this is well defined and that this indeed defines a valid scalar product. So given these two objects, we have a Hilbert space. So RD can be seen as a Hilbert space of function. It's a linear space with an inner product, and as a Hilbert space of functions, it has a reproducing kernel. And the reproducing kernel is what we call the Christoffel Darboux kernel. Okay, so the Christoffel Darboux kernel is the reproducing kernel, and the reproducing property is written here. Reproducing means that for any polynomial P, the evaluation at a given Z can be computed by using the scalar product involving the kernel. So the kernel has two arguments. It's polynomial and it's of degree at most d. We have seen a formula to compute the kernel from the moment matrix. So if I choose a basis of function, I can define the moment matrix of the measure mu in this basis. It's defined through this integral. In this case, v is essentially a vector of polynomials, and I can compute the kernel by this formula here. So it requires inversion of the moment matrix and multiplying on the left and on the right by this big vector of polynomials involved in the basis. We have also seen some connections with orthogonal polynomials. So the kernel has an expression. If I take an orthonormal basis with respect to the scalar product induced by mu, then there is a very simple expression to compute the kernel given this basis. So for those two formula, it does not depend on the basis. So you can choose any basis you want. Maybe the p will change here, pi will change, but the sum here will not change. It will be the same. And the last thing that I wanted to recall is the Christoffel function, which is closely related. So it's the value of a certain minimization problem. So I'm optimizing over polynomials of degree at most d. I have this linear constraint that the evaluation of the polynomial at the argument of the function is 1, and I'm minimizing this integral of p squared d mu, which is a quadratic positive definite quadratic form. So that's the definition of the Christoffel function, and the connection with the kernel is as follows. The value of the Christoffel function at a given z is 1 over the value of the kernel at z. And furthermore, we have a solution, an expression for the optimal solution. Okay, so now let's get for the plan of today. So today, what I would like to show, to describe, and illustrate is the fact that the Christoffel Darboux kernels captures some properties of the underlying measure. So first, we will talk about the univariate case, and then I will present a multivariate case, and if time permits, I will introduce the construction of the kernel in the singular case, which requires some additional care. Okay, so see the kernel. captures major theoretic properties in the univariate case. So first, let's get back to some exercises that I gave you last week in the source and exercise section. There was one exercise here, which was as follows. So here you recognize the Christoffel function. So mu here is a compactly supported Borel probability measure. I do not ask it to be absolutely continuous. It could be absolutely continuous, but it doesn't have to be. In this case, I can still use the variational form for the Christoffel function, the minimization over a certain set of polynomials. And that gives me the Christoffel function. So it's defined here through the minimization form. And now the question is, what is the limit of this thing as d goes to infinity? Okay, so d is the degree bound. And one first is result is the following. If I fix x0 in Rp, then the limit of lambda d evaluated at x0 when d goes to infinity is the weight which is given for the singleton x0. So if mu is absolutely continuous, this will be zero. But if mu is not absolutely continuous, it could be a positive quantity. So let's prove this thing, because I think it's a good good exercise and a good way to see to manipulate the object. So let me get back to the chat. Yeah, chat. Okay, no question in the chat. So if you have questions, please ask in the chat, and I will try to answer as the lecture goes. Okay, so pure points. Okay, maybe not this color. This color, pure points. Oh, so let's recall what is the definition of the Christoffel function. So here mu is compactly supported, and it's a probability measure. Okay, and I'm going only to do the univariate case. The multivariate case is very similar, it's just a different weighting, but we are going to focus on this. So let's recall the formula for the Christoffel function. At a given z, the value of the Christoffel function is equal to the minimum under the constraint that p of z is equal to 1. P is a polynomial of degree at most d of the integral of p squared against d mu. Okay, so from this formula, we have one side of the limit. So if p of x zero is equal to 1, then we have that the integral of p squared of x d mu x, d mu x, is greater or equal to mu of the singleton x0 times p of x0, which is equal to 1. So the thing here is equal to mu of the singleton of x0. Okay, so that's property of the integral. And so with this inequality here and the formula for the Christoffel function, we deduce that lambda d mu of x0, so the consequence of this is that lambda d mu of x0 is greater than mu of the singleton x0. So we have one side of the inequality. Let's prove the other side of the inequality. And the other side, this is very classical. We will essentially use the same formula, so the variational form here, and exhibit some polynomial, which gives us the desired result. So as I said, I'm working in the univariate case. The multivariate case is similar, but the scaling is slightly different. So in the univariate case, we have seen last time affine invariants of the Christoffel function. So I can assume without loss of generality that mu is supported on minus 1, 1 and x0 is equal to 0. So this is without loss of generality by affine invariance. I can shift and scale as I want the value of the Christoffel function. Modulo the same shift and scaling will not change. Okay. In this case, for any d in n, I have the following. So first, lambda 2d plus 1 mu of 0 is smaller or equal to lambda 2d mu of 0. So the reason why there is 2d plus 1 and 2d here is just because I'm going to use degree 2 polynomial. So I need to take care of even and odd degrees. And I'm going to use the formula here, okay? And to use the formula here, since I'm taking the minimum, I can choose any polynomial p which value at 0 is 1 and which is of degree at most 2d. Okay, and so I obtain the following integral of 1 minus x squared to the 2d d mu of x. So why do I obtain this? Essentially, I choose p of x equals 1 minus x squared to the d. Okay, so if I choose p of x equals 1 minus x squared to the d, this is a polynomial of degree 2d. Okay, and so I can put it in the and the value, and also in addition we have p of 0 equal 1. Okay, so I can put it as a candidate solution in the minimization problem, and I get an upper bound on the value here. Now I can decompose my integral into two terms. So this goes as like this. The first term will be the integral restricted to small value of x. So here I pick d 1 over d to the 1 fourth. I know that 1 over d to the 1 fourth is going to work. Okay. So the polynomial is smaller than 1, so I can I'm supported on minus 1, 1. So the polynomial here, p of x, is smaller than 1. So I'm just integrating 1 on this small interval here. And the other term will be the integral over the complement. So norm of x greater than 1 over d to the 1 fourth of 1 minus x squared. The 2d, and this is d mu of x. Okay. So I keep the first term as it is. It doesn't change. Okay. So x is smaller than 1 over d to the 1 fourth. And the other term, since I'm integrating minus 1, 1, but I remove the small ball around 0. I know also that I have a probability measure. I can upper bound the second term as follows. 1 minus 1 over square root d. Okay, so I take the smallest value of the polynomial on this set. This is for x equals 1 over d to the 4. So the value is 1 over square root d to the 2d. Okay. And now the thing that we have here goes to zero as d goes to plus infinity. And the thing that we have here, it goes to mu of zero as d goes to plus infinity. Okay, so this shows that the value of the Christoffel function is upper bounded by something that converges to mu of evaluated at the singleton zero, and so we have both an upper bound and a lower bound on the value of the Christoffel function. Yep. So let's get back to the presentation. So what's interesting about it is that essentially it says that if we have an absolutely continuous measure, it goes the limiting value of the Christoffel function is zero. Okay, so the Christoffel function is decreasing to zero as d goes to infinity. If we don't have an absolutely continuous measure, then we could eventually get the pure point point pure point part of the measure, sorry. So get singletons which carry positive mass. And already by this simple result, we see that the Christoffel function captures some information regarding the underlying probability measure. Let's do a second exercise. Okay, so I formulated it with random variables because I think it's meaningful. So again, I take a compactly supported probability measure here. Probability measure, and I ask it this time to be absolutely continuous. So if it is absolutely continuous, we can do the construction that we did last time. Everything will work the same as last time. In particular, we have all the formulas involving the moment matrix and the orthogonal polynomials. So the question is, we know that lambda goes to zero. Essentially, in this case, mu of the singleton x0 will be zero for any x0 because the measure is absolutely continuous. So we know that the measure is going to zero, the Christoffel function is going to zero pointwise. The question is, what is the typical value? How fast does it go to zero? And here, so the result says that if I take a random variable z with distribution mu, so mu is a probability measure, then the expectation of z, the average value of lambda d mu of z, so you need to be careful, there is an inverse here. So mu is becoming small, so the inverse is becoming big. So this quantity here is going to infinity, essentially. And the question is, what is its speed? And so this is an element of answer, the average speed, essentially the average speed of the inverse of the Christoffel function is this number, which is equivalent to d to the p. So the average speed is essentially polynomial in d, and d and the power is p. P is the dimension. Okay, we are working on rp. So let's give it a proof also, because it's actually very easy. So average value. So the only thing that we need to use is the formula involving orthogonal polynomials. So let's consider P1 PSD orthonormal with respect to the scalar product induced by mu. Then, so the expectation when z is distributed according to mu of the quantity of interest, so lambda d mu z with minus one here, is equal to, so lambda d mu z is the inverse of the Christoffel Darboux kernel. So essentially, this is the kernel evaluated at xx, and I integrated against d mu of x. So this is the average value of the kernel. And now I can use the formula that we had for the Christoffel Darboux kernel. The Christoffel Darboux kernel is just the sum of the orthogonal polynomials. So here, if I evaluate at xx, then I get a square. And using orthonormality, each of these polynomials will, when I square it, so it amounts to compute the scalar product with itself, it will be equal to one. Okay, so just permuting the sum and the integral, I get that this is equal to SD, which is the number of the dimension of the space of polynomials in p variable with degree at most d. Okay, so we have two elements here. The first one is lambda goes to zero. The second one is it goes to zero on average, let's say, at a speed which is roughly polynomial, which is polynomial in D, and we know the polynomial factor. Okay. Any questions so far? No question. So this is very rough, and actually things are much more precise. And we will see some like two results here in the univariate case. So those results are pretty recent. Actually, they came out in the early 90s. So it's been 30 years, but it's not not so long compared to the history of orthogonal polynomials and related questions. Okay, so the result is due to Matenevay and Totic, and it goes as follows. So I'm in dimension one, and I suppose that I have a probability measure which has a positive density on minus one, one. So the density is F here. The density should be positive and it should be continuous. Okay. So this defines my probability measure mu. Then, so the main result in this work is as follows. So lambda goes to zero in this case because I'm absolutely continuous, so I have no weight on singletons. It goes to zero. We know that the typical speed should be SD, but in this case SD is just D. Okay, and so let's investigate the limit of this quantity here, which is just lambda rescaled by the speed to which it goes to zero. And this they show that this has a limit, so there is a constant term pi which doesn't really matter. We recover the density term here, and there is this square root of 1 minus x squared, which is this half circle shape, which is related to the fact that the measure is supported on minus 1, 1. So that's how the result looks like in a formula, and that's how it looks like with a picture. So here I take a density, a constant density, so the restriction of Lebesgue measure to the segment minus one one. So the color here highlights the value of the degree, and what is represented here, it's not the Christoffel function, but the Christoffel function normalized multiplied by the constant, the value of the degree d. So I just plot this rescaled term, and in this case, the result predicts that the limit should be pi times square root of 1 minus x squared, and this is actually exactly this half ellipsoid shape where the curve seems to go. So this limit is pointwise, and for almost all x in the segment. So this was for x in the segment. Now we may ask what's going on for points which are outside the segments, and it turns out that we can also say something very precise, and this is a different result. You can find it in the book of Stahl and Totic on general orthogonal polynomials. So again, it's the early 90s, and let's say that the setting is similar. So we have a measure, so we didn't put continuous here, but let's assume continuity for simplicity. So same setting, measure on minus one, one with a continuous density, positive continuous density. Now the question is what happens outside of the support, outside of the segment. And outside of the segment, we have the following results. So let's parse a bit what it means. So I have lambda d which goes to zero, but this thing is not this time multiplied by d, it's to the power 1 over d. So 1 over d is going to zero, and the result says that the limit of this thing pointwise should be strictly smaller than 1. So actually the result is much deeper than this, because they compute the limits and they give they related to known quantity in potential theory. For us, the most simple way to see it is that the limit is strictly smaller than 1. So this means essentially that the convergence, so the lambda goes to zero, but the speed at which it converges to zero is essentially exponential in D. Okay, so the limit will be some rho smaller than 1, and the typical value, the value of lambda will be of the order of rho to the 2D. Okay, so it's a some number smaller than 1 divided, to the power of D. So it's going to zero exponentially fast. So this is a dichotomy between the interior and the exterior of the segment. And here you have the same kind of plot. So I plotted the quantity that is in the result here. And we clearly see that it seems to stabilize to a value which is strictly smaller than 1 outside of the segment. So what does all this mean? It means that essentially we have a dichotomy between the interior and the exterior of the support, so at least in dimension one. If we are in the interior of the support of the measure, then the growth of the CD kernel, so again, the Christoffel function goes to zero, means that the CD kernel goes to plus infinity, and we have some estimate of the speed, so the growth of the CD kernel is at most polynomial in the interior of the support, and it's at least exponential in D outside of the support. So this is for us the main interest. I think in the results that I presented, there are many relations to other objects in mathematics, in approximation theory. But for us, I think this will be the most interesting part. Another interesting result is that the limit involves the product of two terms, a density term and a term which is specific to the geometry of the support. So if I get back to this result, indeed in the limit, we recover the density multiplied by some term which is related to the support. And we will see that this has some generalizations to higher dimensions. So this is not the end of the story. This has been generalized to more complex measure in dimension one, and this has been also generalized in higher dimensions and in non-Euclidean settings, but this is a different story, I think. So those asymptotics were qualitative, and the next part is dedicated to quantitative estimates in the multivariate setting. And before carrying on, let's see if there are any questions. There doesn't seem to be any question here. Which measure mu did I use for the plots? You mean? I used the constant measure, which I mean the Lebesgue measure restricted to the support. In this case, the density is plotted here, and here I did not plot the density. I think that answered the questions. Another question? Thanks. Okay, no question. quantitative asymptotics. So how are these quantitative bounds produced? Essentially, they are produced by studying orthogonal polynomials on specific sets. So this is a complicated matter, and it requires a lot of work. So there is a very nice book by Dunkel and Chu on the topic. So they devise orthogonal polynomials and their properties for many special sets. I'm not going to go into the details for all possible sets. I'm just going to illustrate how it could go for an easy set, which is the cube. Okay, so first let's introduce Legendre polynomials. So they could be defined like this recursively. The first one is zero, the second one is the identity, and then I have this recursion formula, which provides me the polynomial of degree n plus one, given the two previous ones. There is a property of those Legendre polynomials. On minus 1, 1, their value is at most 1, and actually this value is attained at x equals 1. So this is not so easy to show, but it's let's take it for granted. Another very interesting property for Legendre polynomials is that they are orthogonal with respect to the uniform measure on minus 1, 1. Okay, so they are not orthonormal. There is the scaling factor here, but so again, here delta mn is zero if m is different of n and one otherwise. So they are orthogonal. If I take two different m and n, then the value on the right is zero. Otherwise, it's the value of the fraction here. And so this property allows to construct orthogonal polynomial, actually orthonormal polynomials. On the cube. Okay, so here it should be orthonormal. And so it goes as follows. I take a multi-index alpha, so it's just a p positive integers. The value, the absolute, I mean, the L1 norm of alpha should be at most d. Okay, so it's here it should be smaller or equal, I'm sorry. Smaller or equal to d, so this corresponds to a monomial of degree d. And instead of taking a monomial, I'm just going to consider le gender polynomial, le genre polynomial indexed by alpha I. Okay, I'm taking the product, so it's the same construction as a monomial, but I just multiply Legendre polynomials. There is this scaling factor here, which is related to the quantity here, and and that's it. So these polynomials, they are indexed by the same kind of indices as monomials, but they form an orthonormal basis for the Lebesgue measure. So we are going to see why, and we are going to check it. And this is very useful because here we have an explicit form of orthogonal polynomials, so we can use it to provide estimates for the Christoffel-Darboux kernel. Okay, so essentially, the Christoffel-Darboux kernel will be related to the sum of these objects, and since all the polynomials P here are bounded by 1 on minus 1, 1, we know that all the polynomials Q here will be bounded by a certain quantity on the cube, and this quantity is precisely the product that we have here. Okay, so each polynomial will be bounded by the term, the constant term in front of it. And so if I want a bound on the Christoffel-Darboux kernel on the cube, so if lambda is the restriction of the Lebesgue measure to the cube, then I can talk about the Christoffel-Darboux kernel related to this measure, and I can compute a bound, an upper bound on this kernel, which has this form. So this inequality is not too complicated to have, and it's also not too complicated to show that the quantity on the right here is of the order of d to the 2p. So the maximal value on the cube is d to the 2p. And here we see something interesting. So the typical value of the kernel, we have seen that it's d to the p. And the maximal value is d to the 2p. So there is a difference between the typical value, let's say the average value, and the supremum on the cube. Okay, let's see, give some arguments why those polynomials are orthogonal, orthonormal on the cube. Polynomials on the cube. Okay. So the first thing to remark is that lambda c, so lambda c is the restriction of Lebesgue measure to the cube, is a product measure. Okay, so it's just the product of a univariate Lebesgue measure on each segment minus 1, 1, and the cube is just the product of all those segments. So this means that if I take a function f, which has a product structure, so f of x will be the product from I equal 1 to p, of fi of x, I. Okay, so this has a separability structure. It's product in xi. Then the integral of f of x with respect against d lambda c of x will be just the product of the integral of each term taken separately. So here, in this case, the integral will be on minus 1, 1. And I will integrate fi of xi, d of xi. And so just because it has a product structure, it allows to compute integrals for separable terms easily. Okay, so now let's choose two multi-indices alpha and beta, and let's compute the integral of q alpha of x against q beta of x. Against the measure, the restriction of the Lebesgue measure on the unit cube. So here I just need to what I will do, yeah, is use exactly this property because the reason I'm allowed to use it is that all those polynomials have this nice product structure. So there is a constant term here, and there is, they are separable. They are made of a product of functions which depend each on only one variable. So I can just write the same formula specific for these things. So I will get here two constants. The first one is alpha I plus 1/2. The second one is beta I plus 1/2. So these are just normalizing constants. Then integral between minus 1 and 1 of p alpha I of xi and p beta I of xi d mu of xi. Okay, and in this case, p alpha I and p beta I are Legendre polynomials, so I know that these things are exactly this thing should be either a number different from zero if those are the same, and otherwise it's zero. And using the normalizing constant that I have in front, what I get, you can check that essentially what you get is the product from I equals 1. Okay, so this should be 1 and this should be 1 also, from 1 to p, of delta alpha I beta I. Okay, so if alpha I is different from beta I, this is 0. If they are the same, then I get a constant which cancels out with the normalizing constant that I have in front. But this is just delta of alpha beta. Okay, this is just delta of alpha beta because this thing is equal to 1 on if and only if all elements alpha I and beta I are equal to 1. Okay, so this shows that the polynomials are orthogonal with respect to the restriction of Lebesgue measure to the cube. And the second thing that we have seen is the fact that this allows to get a bound on the value of the Christoffel-Darboux kernel on the cube. So for any x in the cube, the Christoffel-Darboux kernel is the sum of the orthogonal polynomial squared. So I get q alpha of x with a square. So I can explicit it. This is the sum for alpha less than d of the product for I equals 1 to p of alpha I plus 1/2. And the last term is pi of xi with a square. Okay. So this is just using the formula for q alpha, and now I can use the fact that the Legendre polynomial are smaller than 1, or for if the argument is between minus 1 and 1. So if x is in the cube, each coordinate will be between minus 1 and 1. So the quantity here will be smaller than the sum for alpha smaller than d of the product for I equals 1 to p of alpha I plus 1/2. Okay, and this is actually tight because if I take x equals the vector of all ones, I get exactly the quantity that I have here. So this expression here is exactly the one that was written here. And I put it in the exercise section. One can check that the quantity here is of the order d to the 2p. Okay, so we have an explicit construction on the cube. And so this one was simple because the Lebesgue measure restricted to the cube has a nice product structure. But this gives you a hint, an idea of how it goes how it could go for other sets. Essentially, studying the Christoffel-Darboux kernel amounts to study orthogonal polynomials. And in some circumstances, we are able to give precise, to construct the polynomial explicitly and to give precise estimates. So we already have an estimate here for the cube. Let's see another result, the unit Euclidean ball. Okay, so let's consider, so these are essentially due to Bose and Shu in separate works, in independent works. So here omega p will be the area of the p-dimensional unit sphere in Rp plus 1. And so they have many results regarding the unit Euclidean ball, but for us, I think those are would be the most interesting. So here, B will be the restriction, will be the unit Euclidean ball, and lambda B will be the restriction of the Lebesgue measure to the unit Euclidean ball. Okay, so again, I'm investigating the Christoffel-Darboux kernel on this ball. for the Lebesgue measure restricted to this ball. So there are two results. The first one is a bound, an upper bound on the value of the kernel at the origin. Okay, so the origin is in the middle of the ball. And so the upper bound is like this. So we have this term here, which is bounded as a function of d. So the remainder here is bounded as a function of d. Omega p is a constant, and sd is essentially d to the p. So the upper bound here is of the order d to the p. So we recover exactly the same kind of value as we had on average. So we have seen that the average value of the Christoffel-Darboux kernel is d to the p. And it turns out that at the origin, the value of the kernel evaluated at zero is close to the average value. Another result is the following. There is a formula for the, so this one is due to Chou. Okay, the first one is due to Boss. The second one is due to Chou. There is a formula for the value of the kernel evaluated at points which are on the boundary of the ball. So the formula is here, and the quantity that we have in the middle is of the order of d to the p plus 1. Okay, so again, we have a similar increase in the value of the growth of the kernel. On the origin is d to the p, which corresponds to the average value. On the boundary, it's d to the p plus 1. So we lose, the growth is faster on the boundary than in the middle. Very interesting asymptotics. Can you please recall what are their consequences for polynomial optimization? For the moment, there is no consequence for polynomial optimization. What I would like to highlight today is see how the Christoffel-Darboux kernel captures information on the support of measures, and the way it does is essentially through different growth of the speed inside and outside the support of the measure. So today we will concentrate on this, and next time we will see how this can be used to polynomial optimization. And the second formula is only for the surface of the ball. Yes. So in the interior of the ball, it's not d to the p plus 1, it's d to the p. And so in the interior it's d to the p, on the surface, on the boundary, it's d to the p plus 1. And we have so this one I'm going to skip. This corresponds to a limiting behavior, but I won't have time to go into the details. So let's consider some more general set. Let's see how this can be used to treat more general measures. Okay, so for the moment we had the ball and the cube, but in polynomial optimization we have measures for which we don't really know a priori where they are supported, etc. So this is a simple exercise. If we have a measure which dominates another one, in the sense that for all measurable a, mu a is greater than mu a, then there is the reversed inequality for the kernels. So the way to prove this is just look at the Christoffel function. So if you have this ordering here, you should have the same ordering for Christoffel function, because it defines through an integral against mu and nu, and the reverse inequality should hold for the kernel. Let's consider the Lebesgue measure on a set with non-empty interior. Then, for all x inside in the interior, the value of the Christoffel-Darboux kernel related to the associated measure is at most d to the 2p, so it's polynomial in p. And if in addition the boundary is smooth, so if the boundary is a smooth hypersurface in RP, then on the boundary, the asymptotic is of the order d to the p plus 1. Okay. So the first result is, we will see how it goes. The second result uses this tubular neighborhood theorem, which I will come back to in a minute. From the asymptotic behavior of the CD kernel, we may get information on the geometry of the support of the measure. Yeah, that's exactly it. So the asymptotics of the CD kernel encodes actually allow to recover the support of the measure. And I'm going to describe today the basics of this, and next time how it goes how it goes in practice. So let's see for this smooth for this measure supported on a general set. So general set. Okay. So S has non-empty interior. So S is a subset of RP. No, sorry, subset of RP. It has a non-empty interior. Okay. So let's do a picture of it. Okay. So this is S, and let's take it. Let's take X here in the interior of S. So if X is in the interior of S, this means that there is a small ball, a small Euclidean ball around X. So X belongs to the interior of S. So this means that there exists BR, centered at X, X of radius R, R positive, okay, such that BR is included in S. BR is a subset of S. So if BR is a subset of S, this means that lambda BR of A is smaller than lambda S of A for any A measurable. Why is that so? So lambda BR is the Lebesgue measure restricted to the small ball, and lambda S is the Lebesgue measure restricted to S. So since BR is included in S, we have this inequality. So we can use the implication of this for the Christoffel-Darboux kernel. So this means that KD computed with respect to lambda s evaluated at xx has to be smaller than KD computed against lambda BR and evaluated at the same point. Okay, so the inequality between the kernel should hold pointwise, and this thing is O of D to the P by the previous results. Okay, so we combine essentially two things. We combine first the fact that if a measure dominates an other, then we have the reverse ordering for the kernel, and then we use the bound on the Christoffel-Darboux kernel that we had for the ball. Okay. So this proves the first identity here, and the second identity can be proved in a similar way. So if X is on the boundary, using the fact that we have a smooth embedded hypersurface, we know that there is a small R such that there is a small ball here. Okay, so this will be X tilde and B here tilde. There is a small ball which is not centered at X tilde. Okay, so in this case, X tilde belongs to the boundary of S. So I cannot put a ball around X tilde, but I can always put a ball around the which touches X tilde, which is not centered at X tilde, but such that X tilde is in the ball. And then I can use a similar reasoning. So in order to be able to put a small ball here, I need some assumption on the boundary of S, and this is why here this works only if S is a smooth embedded hypersurface. Okay, so if I have a general set with non-empty interior and smooth boundary, essentially I know the order of magnitude of the Christoffel-Darboux kernel on the set. Now let's see what happens outside the set. So if S is a compact set and mu is a probability measure supported on S, so here I don't need at all the probability measure to be absolutely continuous. I just need it to be supported on the set S. There is no absolute continuity assumption here. Then we have the following result. For all X which stands at distance at most at least delta from S, so for each X such that the distance between X and S is at least a certain given delta, the value of the Christoffel Dabu kernel computed against measure mu at xx is exponential in D. Okay, so here I have the quantity delta, which appears here, but which is fixed, which does not depend on D. I have the diameter of S, which is also fixed, and so I have the term D, which appears here in the exponent. So the growth is exponential in D outside of the tuple. We have a question. Oh no, no question. Okay, so how is this proved? This is proved essentially in the same way as we did for the first exercise of the lecture. Essentially, you exhibit a polynomial which gives to the Christoffel function a very small value. And this polynomial is it's due to Kroh essentially, and this is what we call the needle polynomial. So I don't have time to go through the construction. This is part of the exercises. But we can see the result. So it goes as follow. If I fix D in N, D different from zero, and delta positive, so it should be positive. I think it's better also if it's smaller than one, because I need it to be smaller than one here. So delta between zero and one. Then there exists a polynomial Q in P variable, which is of degree at most 2D. It's actually of degree 2D. Okay, so the degree of Q is 2D, and it satisfies the following. So the value of Q at zero is one. Q is smaller than one on the unit ball. So the value of Q on the unit ball is smaller than one. And much more interesting, the value of Q is very, very small on the unit ball if I remove the small ball of radius delta centered at the origin. Okay, so if x is of norm bigger than delta, then the value of q is small here. So again, delta is fixed. If I fix delta and if I let d increase, so the degree of q will increase, but the value of q will decrease exponentially fast outside the unit ball. And this is how this polynomial looks like. So it's the value at the origin is one. Okay, so you have it for delta equals 0.2 and different values of the degree. And essentially, this polynomial is mimicking something which looks like a Dirac. So the value at zero is one, and it stays at one. It doesn't move, so it's not really a Dirac, but the value stays at one. And the value outside the ball of radius 0.2 is decreasing as the degree increases, and in this picture you can see that it's very small. Okay, so let's see how this polynomial can be used to prove the lower bound, and that would be the last bound for today, I guess. So exponential lower bound. Okay, so here I fix an x, so I suppose that x doesn't belong to S, and I suppose that the distance between x and S is equal to delta. So the in the result I suppose that the distance was bigger than delta, but it doesn't really matter because the bound that we have here is increasing as a function of delta. So so I may suppose that the distance between x and s is equal to delta, and that would be sufficient for the proof. So I said delta tilde to be equal to delta over delta plus diameter of s. Okay, so it corresponds to the quantity that we have, a quantity which appears in the bound. And I can use the needle polynomial of Kroh. So there exists, so for any D, there exists a polynomial Q of degree at most 2D. Okay, and this polynomial satisfies the following. It satisfies Q of 0 is equal to 1. It satisfies norm of Q of X is smaller than 1 if norm of X is smaller than 1. and it satisfies absolute value of Q of X smaller than 2 to the 1 minus delta tilde D if norm of X is greater than delta tilde. And also smaller than 1. Okay, and now from this polynomial, I can consider P to be the polynomial which associates so let's not use X because we already used it. So let's put X0 here, okay. This will be X0. And P, the polynomial which associates to X the value Q of X minus X0 divided by delta plus diameter of S. Okay, so this this polynomial, it's of degree 2D in X, and it can be used as a test polynomial in the Christoffel function. So we have P of X0 equals 1, and we have P of X smaller than so absolute value of P of X smaller than 2 to the 1 minus delta tilde D if for any X in S. Okay, so for any X in S, the value of the polynomial P is bounded by this quantity. This is by the properties of Q and by the construction of the polynomial. So essentially, if X belongs to S, this means that the distance between X and X0 is greater than delta, and this means that Q is evaluated at some X tilde, let's say, which satisfies the inequality here. Okay, and from this, you can deduce that lambda d mu of X0 is smaller or equal to 2. Okay, so it should not be D, it should be 2D, I'm sorry, because the test polynomial is of degree 2D. D should be smaller or equal to the integral of P square of X d mu of X. Okay, and this is smaller than 2 to the 2 minus 2 delta tilde D. Okay, and delta tilde is the value that we have here. So this is not the end of the story. You need to take care of odd and even exponents, odd or, and even degree, sorry. But essentially, this gives you the idea how we get this exponential bound. So this is an upper bound which is going to zero very fast. And so kappa 2d mu of x0, which would be equal to 1 over lambda 2d mu of x0, will be greater than the inverse of this one. So then I get 2 delta tilde d minus 2. Okay, so I get an exponential lower bound on the value of the kernel. Okay, so question. Here you assume that the measure is absolutely, no, for this one, I did not assume that the measure is absolutely continuous. Because it's all about the distance. So you can do the same thing for singular measures. So for the to work in the interior of the support, you need some absolute continuity assumption. But here the measure is not absolutely continuous, and the only thing that I used is the value of the polynomial here, and the fact essentially that, so the picture is like this. You have the set S here, and you have a small ball around X here. So I'm rescaling the needle polynomial Q so that this would correspond to the unit sphere, and this, the small ball here, would correspond to the value delta. Okay, so if I'm outside of the support, I can put a small ball around X which doesn't touch the support, and a big ball centered at X which contains the support, and then play a bit with it. So this is the only thing that I need. and I don't need absolute continuity. Okay, so let's recap before finishing for today. So I take here the Lebesgue measure restricted to S, and I assume that S is compact and has non-empty interior. The fact that it has non-empty interior is just to have a discussion on the value of the kernel in different parts of the space. Okay, so we have seen two things. The first thing is if I'm in the interior of this set, then the Christoffel-Darb kernel has growth, which is at most a polynomial in D, and it's at most D to the P. If I'm outside the kernel, then the growth is exponential in D. And here you can see that this dichotomy between exponential growth outside and polynomial growth inside would help in principle to get access to the support as the degree would go to infinity. Okay, we would just need to separate the points which have exponential growth, which correspond to exponential growth of the kernel, and points which correspond to polynomial growth on the kernel. So that's for next time, and we know actually a bit more. We know that if the boundary is smooth, so if we look at a boundary point which correspond to a smoothness point, then the growth is d to the p plus 1, so we lose an order of magnitude, or we gain, I don't know, so the speed is an order of magnitude faster when we get to the boundary. And actually we saw the example with the cube, and you can convince yourself if you reach a corner here. We are in R2, so if we reach a corner, the speed is again increased by an order of magnitude. So essentially what happens is each time you lose a dimension because you go to a face or to a corner if each time you lose a dimension, essentially you gain an order of magnitude of speed in the growth of the kernel. And the last thing that I didn't mention, the behavior on the boundary could be non-polynomial. So in the exercise section, you have an example of a set for which the growth of the kernel is exponential, so not exponential in D, but exponential in square root D. So essentially, if you have a point here on the boundary, and if this point corresponds to a cusp, then if the cusp is very nasty, the growth here could be much faster than a polynomial in D. Okay. So I think we could probably stop here for today. Next time, what we will do is see how this picture would help to recover the support given knowledge of the Christoffel-Darb kernel. So if you have questions, I think it's time to ask, and I will try to answer. Thank you for listening. And if there are no questions, it is fine. Okay, so it seems that there is no question. What would the...
So, Edouard, I think
yes.
You are way too clear.
Ah, yeah, probably, yeah. No, but this is completely fine. Huh?
So, well, if there are no questions, in view of the fact that you have to run to another seminar, maybe...
What is the alpha in the in the exponential behavior? Okay, that's a good question. So in this one, so in the one that we have here, the alpha is essentially this one. Okay, so it's here the exponent is in base 2. So if you want to translate it in base e, that would give you some number, and then the exponent depends essentially on the size of the support. and on the distance to the support. Okay, so the alpha is essentially this thing. So if you're very far from the support, it's close to one. If you're very close to the support compared to its diameter, it's decreasing and eventually go to zero as you get to the support. And so this is for outside, and on the boundary here, it really depends on the geometry, the local geometry. If you have a cusp, it should be an exponential cusp, and it depends how this cusp looks like around this point. Will you please upload this video? I think so, Monique. You can confirm, maybe.
Yes, it will be uploaded, yes.
Do you think that these kinds of results can be extended to the case of non-commutative polynomials? Yeah, I'm not the best one to. You should ask Victor Macron about this, I guess. The answer is I don't know. Probably you could do similar things, but I'm not familiar at all with non-commutative polynomials, so I cannot really say. Okay, your last asymptotics are for the uniform measure. What about other measures? So that's a very good question, and I did not mention. So if you have a density, you can use this. So if you have a density with respect to Lebesgue measure, and if this density is strictly positive, then you can use domination. Essentially, if you have a density which is continuous and strictly positive, you can sandwich the measure between two rescaled Lebesgue measures, so a small one and a bigger one. So essentially, you can sandwich your kernel between two kernels for which you have precise estimates. So the orders of magnitude will not change; the constants will change. Okay. So if you have a positive density, or like, let's say, a density which is both upper bounded and lower bounded, then that works. If you have a density which is not positive, for example, if it decreases to zero as you go to the boundary of the support, then there are extensions of these kinds of results. Okay, so this is for the Lebesgue measure, but there are extensions for different weight functions which decrease to zero as you get to the boundary of the ball, and the results will be different. So you can still use similar tricks. You need to be a bit careful about the geometry, about what it means to compare measures. And in this case, that would work. Maybe last element of answer to that question, if you have a measure which is singular, then you should be careful about the way you construct first the Christoffel-Darboux kernel, and so the asymptotics, maybe I will have time to talk about it a bit next time, but if the measure is singular, then you should use other tricks, and the difficulty is that there are not so many references, so you have many references for measures which are supported absolutely continuous with respect to Lebesgue measure. If you are not, then there are not so many references measure which you could use to get estimates for the speed of divergence of the Christoffel-Darboux kernel. Yeah. Okay. So for polynomial optimization, maybe I hope we will go into these details next time. So I have some work to present regarding this. Yeah. So the idea essentially is that it depends on the application. I will show one application in polynomial optimization. The idea is from the hierarchy you get pseudo moments, and those pseudo moments ideally they are close to moments of a measure. And the problem is that from moments, it's complicated to get an idea of what is the geometry of the underlying support, for example. And so the Christoffel-Darboux kernels, it has two appealing properties. First, it is computed from moments. And then second, it is it captures information on the support. Okay, so the idea is exactly this, but it depends on the on what you what setting you use exactly. So you don't really know in advance what will be the support of your measure. So if you know in advance that the measure is supported on a set with non-empty interior, then yes, you could just divide by the CD kernel by D to the P and see where this quantity is not going to zero. Okay. And that will give the support. The problem is that you don't really know in advance what would be the support of the underlying measure. And in this case, you need to have a discussion about, for a specific application, let's say you know the optimal measure, you know that the moments are going to get close to moments of a given optimal measure for which you have information on the support, and then you should, based on this knowledge, adapt the thresholding scheme that you use, but that's essentially the idea. So you get you need to take compute the Christoffel-Darboux kernel, take a threshold value, and that gives you a contour of an estimate of something that is close to the support. And next time, I will show an application for measures which are supported on singular sets. Examples of results where the measure is computed from the hierarchy for I think optimal control and also PDEs. Yes. Okay. So,
okay. So, if there are no more questions, so let me thank again Edouard very much for the nice lecture, and
thank you.
See you next week.
Yes, see you next week. Thank you for organizing this.
Yes, thanks a lot for the talk.
Have a nice day.
Yeah, thank you very much, Edouard. Have a nice day too, and bye everybody.